afternoon, John. Just go ahead with the as two for one here with the two plays that flipped the field on special teams, the throwback pass and then also Dowdle's kickoff return. If you could describe those plays and what unfolded.
Hey, David, can you ask your question again, please? I'm sorry.
Yeah, John, just kind of a two for one. Can you talk about the two plays on special teams that flipped the field for you, the throwback pass and then also Dowdle's kickoff return down the right sidelines?
Yeah, those were two, I mean, really good plays executed by our guys. The first one was the throwback I think you're talking about, where we practiced it a lot this past week, and we had the right situation as far as the down and distance, you know, everything kind of aligned. And so we made the call real quick. Guys were excited about it. We practiced it a lot this week, and everything kind of just, all the stars aligned for that one. So that was when we practiced a lot this week and was well executed by the guys. The second one, the kickoff return, was a really unique one where they kicked it from the 50, and we had practiced it before, but that one we haven't practiced a lot, you know, kickoff returning from an opponent kicking off from the 50. So that's a pretty unique play where we're definitely alert for the bloop that could go left or right, which determines our return direction. And they blooped it to Rico, who hadn't handled the ball yet this year on kickoff return. And he knew what to do with it, thank goodness, and made a heck of a play. I mean, a great run by Rico setting up the blocks, and our guys blocked it up pretty dang good.
John, a little off the beat here. We asked you a bunch of times about the Jeopardy stuff and everything in training camp and with Alex Trebek's passing. I'm just wondering if there is any, have you ever met him, ever talked to him, anything like that? And just your thoughts on him.
Yeah. I mean, it's so funny you asked that because, you know, it's been a while since I've been a huge Jeopardy fan, but I was a huge Jeopardy fan for so long. And when I didn't know of his passing, I think it was 80 years old. And when I heard that, I immediately thought of, you know, the past 15 years that I've done a Team Jeopardy for the different teams I've been on and how it's kind of evolved the way I've run it. And just knowing that he's always been on our PowerPoint slide number one, Alex Trebek's picture's been up there with the Jeopardy tune. So next year we'll definitely do a little tribute to him and honor him on the 16th year I'll do it. So, yeah, I'm glad you asked that. Thanks for asking. I've never met him. Unfortunately, I won't get the chance to, but much love for him for putting together a fun thing for us for training camp.
Thanks for that. And I'm wondering, do you feel like your group has kind of settled down, I guess, after the start of the season that you've had, that you found some consistency?
Yeah, I think, you know, just more practice at situational football and, you know, just getting to know each other, you know, me understanding maybe the strengths and limitations of our players and, you know, what I think we can do best, you know, is what I've learned and what we're trying to focus on. So there was definitely just, you know, some feeling out process and a lot of practice that we needed and we still need. So I think in the meetings, they've been so locked in on the practice field. They work hard, and that's really what's, I think, helped us improve. And there's still a lot of room to go, so I'm optimistic that we're going to get even better.
Calvin, did you have anything?
No, thank you.
All right, Michael?
John, with the loss of Wednesday's practice due to COVID protocols that are now in place, I was just curious, what were you hoping to accomplish in that bye week practice?
I was going to go back and just do some real simple fundamental drills, you know, punt return blocking, kickoff return front line technique, maybe some open field tackle drills. So nothing that would have been, you know, real schematic or required a lot of, you know, thinking or much from their brains, but It's really a good time about midseason to go back to just some training camp drills when you're talking really tackling and blocking technique. So that was going to be our goal. But we do that anyways during the week, so I'll just make sure I reinforce it for sure when we get back to work next Monday.
I noticed Cedric Wilson, we saw more of him and less of CeeDee Lamb at punt returner. Was that because you were trying to, Cedric's throwing ability, were you just trying to set up that eventual fake and then it just came earlier in the game and you went through with it in terms of his usage at punt returner? Or what was the rationale behind that?
You're good, man. You're good. Yeah. We've rotated both of them in there all season. And that was one where we thought, you know, let's get Cedric back there on that first one. The first one we rushed and we like to have Ced back there. Was it a setup? Maybe. No, but if you go back, you look, we've had them both back there. And I feel great about both of them being back there. But, you know, Cedric's ability to throw, obviously he was going to be back there for the throwback. And looking at the coach's tape, I mean, that was an incredible catch over his shoulder, ran the opposite way to the sideline and flung that thing back on a dime. I mean, we did it in practice, and in practice it didn't look that good. So I'm just really proud of the guys for executing a very, very high-level punt return that, you know, had some danger element to it, and they pulled it off, and proud of them for it.
Is your heart in your throat as that ball's going across the air and as CJ bobbles it?
No, I mean, that's funny you asked that, because obviously we knew what we were looking for, and really as soon as he punted it, when you see that he boomed it and that nose was going to turn down, and I just took a peek, you know, just across the other side of the field to see if there was anybody cover-wise leaking over there, and ball was probably at its peak, and in my head I said, I think we got him, you know, then as soon as Ced caught it, you know, with that much space, you could tell that, you know, things were getting set up the right way, so my heart was actually definitely not in my throat, because right about peak of the punt, I felt we had a good shot at it.
Hey, Coach, you mentioned Rico hadn't had a return until Sunday. Was that planned to get him as part of the rotation, or was it an adjustment with Tony being a little bit more involved at the running back position yesterday?
No, that was purely because they were kicking off from the 50. So we have Rico in on kickoff return as basically a back-end blocker, but knowing they were going to bloop it left or right on the kickoff from the 50, we just split Tony and Rico up. Tony went left and Rico went right because they were going to either bloop it left or right, and I didn't want Tony back there by himself chasing a ball left or right. So we just placed one guy right in the bloop hole, and whoever it came to, that was who was going to run it. And it's really another high-level, you know, kickoff return for our blockers, because two things could have happened. It could have gone left or it could have gone right. And so for the returners, it was pretty simple, but for the guys blocking on the front line, was very difficult, to be honest with you, because it could have gone two different ways. And so for those guys to, you know, they had about 15 yards of sprinting to adjust to where the kick was going. And it just, you know, I wish you guys could sometimes be in the meetings just to see what takes place, because it's not complicated, but it just takes, you know, guys to be so locked in and on the same page, and all front eight blockers have to be doing the same thing with the same return direction without saying anything to each other. So a lot of stuff happened that was really good, but it took a lot of attention to detail, and they nailed it. I mean, man, that's most of the time when teams kick from the 50, you're lucky to get that ball to the 20, and for us to dig it out of there and give us a shot at some, you know, point field position was impressive.
John, Coach McCarthy mentioned yesterday before the game that one of the plans for the bye week was to do what he called across the hall with the offensive coaches coaching the defensive players and vice versa. Are y'all still planning to do that with COVID, and what does that mean for you as the special teams coordinator, if so?
Yeah, as coaches, our plan is to produce some presentations for our players, so when they come back next Monday, we'll do across the hall, where basically defensive guys are coaching offensive guys are coaching defensive guys. And I don't have a big role in that because it's really on the, you know, offense and defensive side. So I'll definitely be a very willing participant in some of those meetings as just basically a spectator. But we did it leading up to the first game of the season, and the players loved it, and the coaches did too. And I think it's just a great thing that Coach McCarthy's brought to us, where the sides of the ball hear the different perspective from the coaches on the other side of the ball. And I think it was a big success in week one just for our players, and Monday we'll do it again, and it's a really cool thing.
Christy, do you want to go ahead? There you go.
Sure. Hi, John. C.J. Goodwin was a captain for the second time this week, and was part of that because he has ties from Wheeling near Pittsburgh. And could you just talk about not only the you talked about his play already in the game on the throwback, but just overall what he has meant as a leader on your special teams unit?
Yeah, great question. This was the second time CJ was a captain. We're just looking for a veteran guy this week to be our captain. CJ got his first start in the NFL with the Steelers as an undrafted guy. So going, you know, playing against the Steelers meant a lot to him. But what he's meant to our team, first of all, just as a player on the field, has been, you know, I mean, undeniable. He's fast. He's tough. He's so versatile. And the really interesting thing about CJ as a leader is he's very quiet. You know, he's not shy, but he really does not say much, which, of course, you guys know when somebody who's quiet says something, it carries a lot of weight. But really where CJ's leadership comes is his work ethic. And I'm not just saying that. It might just be just the coach talking. But the way he, you know, the way he works at practice, you could put tape on there and let everybody see it, how it's supposed to be done. And that's really CJ's way to lead, is definitely by he's showing him how to do it. And he's not really saying much. And he means a lot to our team and a ton to our special teams. And I love the guy, and I'm super proud of him, and I think there's a lot more to come where this has come from as far as production in the future.
And we'll go ahead and finish up here with Calvin, unless somebody else has something after Calvin.
Coach, going on with COVID, will you still have your workouts this week with your punters?
You know, that's a great question. I need to talk to Will McClay about that. That's a great question. I think we're still determining exactly what we're allowed to do. And I've been in here honestly working on the film all day on future opponents and our self-scout. So I've still kind of been holed up in the cave. So I don't have all the information, but thanks for reminding me. I need to check on that.
No problem. Just text me when you get the information.
Yeah, thanks for letting me know.
Yeah. How did Hunter do in that game for you?
Hunter did good. You know, I was on him, probably annoying in him just to, hey, just get rid of the football. You know, operation time's got to be under this. So I was speeding him up. I know it. But his holding was outstanding, which was a big part of his job. His handling of the punt operation was outstanding. And the more work he gets, I think the punting will improve. But for the start, I wanted him to have a legitimate NFL punt operation time, which is under 2 seconds, and I wanted his holding to be spot on, and he nailed both. His operation time was under 2 for both punts, and Greg didn't miss any kicks. So I would say first game success by Hunter.
I had one question, John, real quick about CJ. On that return, it looked like when he was getting back into position, he grabbed his hamstring. Is that something you had him add in there, or did he do that on his own just to kind of draw attention away from himself?
Yeah, we talked about that. That was kind of part of the plan, because if anybody happened to see him, we wanted to make him think that he was, you know, injured and kind of walking away from the play. The interesting thing was the punter punted it so far that he started, you know, kind of faking. Everybody knows it. He started faking pulling his hamstring, and then he realized he still had about 40 more yards to run. So his hamstring miraculously healed, and he had to sprint behind the ball so Sid could make the lateral. So that was part of the plan. It was kind of part of the fun this week, trying to think of all the modes of deception you could use for plays like that. And whether it works or not, I don't know, but it was, you know, it's fun for the guys during the week.
All right, we'll go to Jory here, and then we'll finish up with Michael Gelkin with the last one.
John, going back to the holding, can you take us through some of what you did to get Hunter ready, and given how key field goals were and what y'all were able to score, how happy were you that it did work out?
Yeah, thanks for asking. LP, our snapper, deserves a ton of praise for what he did with our with Hunter this week as far as the holding goes. We did a ton of drills. Hunter must have handled a couple hundred balls this week just on the holding aspect of it. And LP did a ton of those drills with Hunter and for Hunter. And so I really, really am really proud of LP for kind of taking Hunter under his wing when Chris has been his guy for so long and spent hours and hundreds of balls, you know, good balls, bad balls, inside balls, outside balls, working on getting it right on the spot, because there's a lot more to holding than just grabbing it and putting it down. You know, it's laces, it's hitting the spot. And so I just, I'm glad you asked, and I really think LP deserves a ton of credit for what he did for Hunter this week when it comes to the field goal operation.
Jory stole my question, but I'll ask another one. With the Hunter workout this week, if it does happen, what are you hoping to ascertain there? Is it possible that your punter for the rest of the season currently isn't on the roster today?
I don't know that, but I was really happy with Hunter. I will definitely say that. I think when you look at what happened like in Tennessee, I think most people the second half of the season are going to have two punters, or at least a backup option as a kicker or punter, at least on their practice squad. In case something happens, you have a next guy who is available who's already gone through the COVID testing protocol. So I believe what we're going to do is just make sure with Hunter as our guy, just have somebody else just in case for COVID reasons more so than performance reasons. Although Hunter knows he's got to perform, and I really believe he will. But I think the extra guy we'll bring in to be on a practice squad will be purely for just having, you know, an emergency option should something happen.